Hello students, in today's lecture we will be discussing a very important topic of the chapter semiconductors, that is metal semiconductor junctions. Now in the previous lectures I have already discussed what a PN junction diode is, or we've discussed a special type of a PN junction diode, that is a Zener diode. Now these two types of diodes which we have discussed, they both have both the type of materials as semiconductors. That is a p-type semiconductor and an n-type semiconductor. But if we discuss about metal semiconductor junctions, so what exactly does it mean? A metal semiconductor junction, commonly known as MS junction, is a type of electrical junction in which a metal comes in close contact with a semiconductor. So basically, junction requires two or more than two materials. Here we use two materials, one is a metal, the other is a semiconductor. Now these metal semiconductor junctions, they can be rectifying also, they can be non-rectifying also. What do you mean by a rectifying junction? They give output only in one type of condition. Non-rectifying means whether you connect them in forward or reverse doesn't matter. They do not require any biasing, they will always give you output. I can give you an example of a non-rectifying device. You can say a resistor. Resistor only opposes the current. You can connect the resistor in any direction. It does not have a positive or negative terminal. Now the metal semiconductor junctions, they typically use, if we consider semiconductor part, they use n-type semiconductors mainly. Why n-type? Because they have majority as electrons. And the metals which are commonly used are molybdenum, platinum, chromium, tungsten. These metals have comparatively a higher conductivity. Now before I move on to the actual topic, let me discuss two important terms which you might remember. I mean, you have studied these terms in chemistry. The two important terms are, one of them is work function. We denote it by the symbol phi. What exactly is work function? It is the minimum energy required to transfer an electron from a point within a solid to a point outside its surface. Or you can say the vacuum just immediately outside the solid surface. Say for example, I consider this portion as a material and my electron is at this level. So the minimum energy which I require to move electron from this level to a point just outside it, that is from the dark gray colored portion to the white portion. So that minimum energy is what is work function. Similarly, we have a term called electron affinity. We denote it by chi n. It is defined as the amount of energy released or spent when an electron is added to a neutral atom or a molecule. If you have a neutral atom, if you add an electron, it is going to be negatively ionized. So there would be some release in energy, right? So that is what is defined as chi n. You can say that it is the likelihood of a neutral atom gaining an electron. Now let me move on to my actual topic. The two types of metal semiconductor junctions are Schottky junction and ohmic junction. Now what do you mean by a Schottky junction? If we consider, now we are having a metal and a semiconductor. Metal has some work function and semiconductor has some different work function. So if we have a relation that metal work function is more than semiconductor work function, we call such a type of junction as Schottky junction, which I'll be discussing in today's lecture. And this type of a junction is called a rectifying junction. Similarly, ohmic junction means if the work function of metal is less than the work function of semiconductor, we call it an ohmic junction and it is a non-rectifying junction. I'll be covering this topic in the next lecture. Now, let me start with Schottky junction. As I just discussed that phi m, work function of metal, is always greater than work function of semiconductor, then such a type of junction will be called a Schottky junction. So suppose we take a metal and a semiconductor such that work function of metal is more than work function of semiconductor. The junction which we get is a Schottky junction. Now before the junction is formed, let us just discuss the individual band diagrams. Band diagrams I have already taught in the lecture of PN junction diode. Right? So we consider the energy band diagram of a metal, wherein metal does not have any conduction or valence band separately because they have overlapping region. So this maximum level where electron is present is the Fermi level. We've already discussed in chapter 1. So from this, the maximum energy, because the electron is here, and it, if we want to move this electron outside the metal, then this is the work function we have considered only in one dimension, just to make it easier to understand. Similarly, if I consider n-type semiconductor, it is having conduction band, electrons in conduction band, because it is n-type. So now the Fermi level of semiconductor lies between donor and conduction band. So it is in between the conduction and the donor level. So from the maximum of conduction to the Fermi level, we have denoted work function. So you can see individually, you can see that the Fermi level of metal is here and the Fermi level of n-type semiconductor is here. So if they are not joined before the junction is made, we can say that the Fermi levels are not in one line. They are one above the other. This has a comparatively a higher level and this has a lower level. Now we know the golden rule as discussed earlier, that Fermi levels should line up when a contact or a junction is made. What do you mean by Fermi levels should line up? The Fermi level of this side and the Fermi level of this side should be one straight line only. This diagram indicates the junction is not yet made. But now, as per the golden rule, when the contact is formed, the semiconductor side is going to give its electrons. Why? Now just assume a scenario that you join both of them. What happens if you join both of them? This side has more electrons, and it has, now compared to semiconductor, metal is having more electrons, but the work function of metal is more than the work function of semiconductor. So there is, you know, semiconductor giving electrons to metal is more likely, right? So when the contact is made, the semiconductor is going to give its electrons as it has a lower work function compared to metals. But now at the same time, semiconductors have a lower charge carrier density compared to metals. They have a carrier density of around 10 raised to 17 per centimeter cube. If you talk about metals, they have a carrier density around 10 raised to 22 per centimeter cube. So electrons are not removed only from the surface, but they are removed from deep within the semiconductor. What does this line mean? Now just assume I have made the junction using a metal and an n-type semiconductor. So here I have to have that Fermi levels are lining up. So I have a straight line. Just to make it easier to understand, I have written EFM, which denotes the Fermi level of metal, and EF semi, which denotes the Fermi level of n-type semiconductor. So here I can say that this line indicates the junction. But if I consider metal, again I'm repeating, metal cannot give its electron. Why? Though it has more electrons, the work function is more. So before metal gives its electron, semiconductor is going to give its electron to metal. Right? Now what happens is, this has more accepting capacity and this has less giving capacity. So not only closer to the junction, from deep within the semiconductor, electrons come to the metal. So you can see that if I consider this line as my junction line, I can say that a very huge area from the junction on the semiconductor side will get devoid of electrons because they have moved to metal. This is what I have written here. As the semiconductor gives its electrons, semiconductors have a low charge carrier density. They have a carrier density around 10 raised to 17 per centimeter cube. So the electrons are not removed only from the surface, but they are removed from deep within the semiconductor. And this results in a depletion layer in the semiconductor region only. If you consider a PN junction diode, the depletion layer is formed in the P and N type both. But here, the depletion is formed only in the semiconductor region. Metals do not have holes. So, no possibility of depletion layer on the metal. As the semiconductor gives its electrons, a positive potential is created on the semiconductor side and negative potential is created on the metal side. This is what I have shown here. Negative on the metal and positive on the semiconductor side. Now, when the junction is made, can you just see this uphill? What does this uphill indicate? That these electrons, the electrons which were able to move, have already moved and created a negative on the metal side, but the remaining electrons have to cross this uphill to move towards the metal side. So they cannot move on their own. And also we can see that there is a, you know, we have defined a barrier called EV0, which is equals to phi m minus phi semi. The difference of these two is nothing but EV0. You can label EV0 here, or you can label EV0 here. So this is nothing but the zero bias of a Schottky junction. The barrier potential does not let further electrons to cross the junction. The electrons are removed from the semiconductor, so the depletion layer is formed on the semiconductor side. Now, what do you mean by chi n? This distance is what is known as its chi n. So I can say that phi m minus chi n, this entire distance phi m minus this distance chi n, will give me a Schottky barrier phi b. This is the barrier responsible for electrons. This is the barrier responsible for not letting the electrons move to metals. Now let us consider a biasing condition wherein we apply external voltage such that the Schottky junction, we apply external voltage to Schottky junction such that it opposes the built-in potential. Why do we get a built-in potential here? Because electrons have moved from n-type to metal. So there is a positive on the semiconductor side and negative on the metal side. So we get a potential moving from metal, from positive to negative, indicated by V0. Okay. So in this condition, if we consider that external voltage is opposing the built-in potential, our built-in potential is in this direction. So naturally, we have to apply voltage in this direction. That means positive terminal of external voltage to be connected to metal and negative terminal of external voltage to be connected to semiconductor. Now let us understand using the energy band diagram. Now using the energy band diagram, this indicates my metal side and this indicates my semiconductor side. Valence band completely filled up, and here also the maximum level of metal is filled up. Now what is happening here? We have connected the n-type semiconductor to negative of battery. So electrons are gaining more energy because of the negative terminal. So this negative terminal pushes the electrons towards the metal side. Earlier that was not possible. Now what happens? We are giving an energy to the electrons in such a way that they are moving towards the junction. So I can say that the height of Schottky barrier is reduced. You can also say that this barrier is also reduced to EV0 minus V. Why? Because V0 is in left direction, the applied voltage is in right direction. So if you increase the applied voltage, definitely this barrier is going to reduce. At the same time, we can also say that the Fermi level is shifting upward. You remember the diagram we discussed related to PN junction, the Fermi level shifting upwards. This Fermi level shifting upward also indicates that electrons are now crossing the barrier and they are moving towards the metal side. So the barrier potential in this case is reduced as electrons on semiconductor now have sufficient energy to cross the junction. The Fermi levels no more line up, but they are shifted. And this shift depends on what is the amount of applied voltage. The depletion layer is also narrowed. The electrons now flow from semiconductor to metal, and hence we say that current starts flowing. There is an exponential increase in current once the barrier is overcome, same as PN junction diode. Now, let us consider another condition called reverse bias. Suppose an external voltage is applied in such a way that it increases the potential barrier. Now, if this external voltage increases the potential barrier, that means we have to connect in reverse bias. That means the metal side will be connected to negative and the semiconductor side will be connected to positive of battery. So let us see in this case what happens. Because the n-type semiconductor is connected to positive of battery, the electrons, instead of moving towards the junction, the electrons will move away from the junction. They will move towards the right side like this. So what happens? This depletion layer, instead of reducing, it will keep on increasing. Similarly, we can say that the Schottky barrier has also increased. And we can say that this barrier has also increased. Why? Because potential barrier is in left direction and the applied voltage is also in the left direction. On the other hand, we can say that the Fermi level is also shifting downwards. It is not shifting upward, it is shifting downward, which indicates the Schottky barrier has also increased, which indicates no electron will move from the semiconductor to the metal. That means there will be no current. The Fermi level does not shift up, but it moves down and the Schottky barrier also increases. And the electrons cannot move towards the junction, leading to no current. So similar to a PN junction diode, we can say that in forward bias only we get current. There is no current when it is connected in reverse bias. So this junction actually is used in a device which is known as a Schottky diode. Schottky diode works similar to a PN junction diode only. But what is the benefit of a Schottky diode over a PN junction diode? Using a Schottky diode compared to a PN junction diode will give us a faster response. It will be used in high power applications. Why does it give a faster response? Because one of the terminals is a metal, and that too a metal having a higher conductivity. Now, a Schottky diode, the symbol is same, a triangle, and this S denotes Schottky, it stands for S. So you can see the triangle is the anode, that is the positive terminal, and this S indicates the cathode, that is a negative terminal. Now if we see the IV characteristics, forward and reverse, similar to a PN junction diode, there is a sudden increase in current. The moment current exponentially increases, that corresponding voltage compared to a PN junction is very small, is around 0.2 volt. Reverse characteristics, again, this diode is never used in reverse because it gives you current in microamperes only. The threshold voltage is less as compared to PN junction diode. That means the response is faster. It is used in rectifiers, clampers, radio frequency mixers and detectors, and it is used to rectify high frequency signals. Comparatively high power applications, we use Schottky diode. Hope the topic is clear. We will be discussing the second type of metal semiconductor junction in the next lecture. Thank you.